we're looking at jumping Jehoshaphat again. Danny actually found a verse, I think, that said that Jehoshaphat leapt over a wall, and evidently that's where the term came from. I love this story. This may be, even if you haven't read the Bible through several times, that's why I have several Bibles. Let's read the Bible through in a year. And as you know, I know that it is a tremendous discipline and a great commitment to read the whole Bible through. But I have found that I've met many people all my life who've read the Bible from beginning to end many times, and I really don't remember much about what the Bible said. It's just like a task. It's like getting something done. It's letting the words run before you and say, well, I finished that book. And then I finished that book. And so I find there's, if you have a choice, I would more highly recommend Bible study. But then sometimes, you know, you might not study everything in the Bible. I have served here, and I have been on two occasions, 10 years at a church and a couple of years at a few churches. Been here since 2012. And God only knows how long a ministry will last or how long we might be in one place or another. But wherever I like, it's important for me to do my very best to preach everything that's in the Bible. There are passages and chapters and books and themes that you probably prefer or that you like. And one reason that I have, I will always have guest speakers and guest preachers. Brother Roger Hammond preached to us last week out of the Psalms on the subject of perfection. And so when you hear different preachers come, they're going to preach on different passages than I do. And sometimes they might preach on a sermon topic or on a part of the Bible that you're familiar with and that's a sermon you may have heard. We like to hear what's familiar to us often. But I believe that many Christians will stand before the Lord one day. It'll not be their fault or they will not be held accountable, but they'll be in heaven and have no idea who Jehoshaphat is. That there will have been parts of the Bible that they have never read or that they have never heard a message preached on. I believe it's all the Word of God. It's all very good. It's all there for a purpose. And a part of the purpose is not just to complete the Word of God, but to complete me and you. So some of the better devotional tools, like our daily bread or the upper room and so forth, will intentionally take you through the Bible. If every time you pick up your Bible, you go, you thumb to those familiar places that you read to yourself, every time you open the Bible, you're not getting enough spiritual nourishment. You need to get in there and you're just, it's like someone who just eats their favorite foods all the time, Terry. And when there's a smorgasbord out here, there's just a banquet of food. We were invited to such a lavish and extravagant expression of appreciation. Friday night, we were at the Wesson Motel, Terry and I, the Gideon Pastor Appreciation Banquet. Boy, it was just like, I felt like the Beverly Hillbillies. I don't know if Terry did, but I am. We were so nice, and they were really going out of their way. So they realized, pastors and their wives, don't go to places like this very often. So we're going to take them out on the town. There's also a wonderful program, Great Singing. But they had a wonderful meal. Let me tell you, it was a salad that just looked like a work of art waiting for us when we got there. And then we had steak and potatoes and broccoli and everything. And as I looked at it, we already knew before we got there, Terry wasn't going to eat any of it. She didn't like it. She's a peculiar eater, if you didn't know that already, giving her food testimony. It bothered the lady over there so badly that she actually went and grabbed somebody by the nose and made them cook her a baked potato and bring out to her plate. And she ate that. But I gave up on her as far as her food eating habits years ago. And so I probably took that lady across the Texas to be very callous because I never missed a beat. I ate mine and hers too. Without even feeling any compassion for my wife or sorrow sadness at all. And I'm sure that was communicated to Lynn. She just was so upset. So, the Word of God, not all of it is appetizing, but all of it is nutritious.
Amen.
All of our Word of God, all of the Bible. Well, let's look here and see, because the title of the message this morning is, what do you do when there's nothing you can do? What do you do when there's nothing that you can do? I confess, I believe in doing things. And bad habit my dad taught me, and dad always taught me, if you want something done right, you have to do it yourself.
Amen.
Well, that's not a good philosophy. It makes it almost impossible for you to delegate things or to share the work, share the load. It's really pompous or prideful to believe that nobody can do things as well as you or as well as I. People can do things, and you know, listen, do you think that I can do things as well as God? No, I can't. But God entrusts me to do things for Him all the time.
Amen.
And many of the things that I do for God, I'm sure that God looks down and He says, bless His heart. You know, look at that, what a mess He made out of that. But it's a, I stopped in this morning and watched Terry teaching Adrian how they were gluing some things together. They were studying about Moses and Miriam. So they were using glue. And so Adrian, of course, has got to do it her way. We've got a drawing in our bedroom that was made by Carice, and it looks awful. It's hardly recognizable, but we've had it been in our bedroom like 40 years, I guess, 30 years. She's only 30 years old. But you know why we love that? It's not because it's great art. It's not because it's pretty. It's not because it's amazingly talented or gifted. The only reason we love it and look at it with, I genuinely, truly love it, is because I love her.
Amen.
I love her. And that's almost the way it is with things. You've probably heard people preach or heard people sing, or you've probably watched people perform, and they just did an awful, terrible job. But really what it's all about is if you love them, you'll love that. You'll love what they do. Well, let's look at the Word of God and learn a little bit about Jehoshaphat. What? I think that I can fix things. I think that I can do things. But really, it's a big dose of humility to find out that sometimes I face things. It's not just that I don't know what to do. That's kind of where I go into step two. I think, I don't know what to do. You see, that's still even the point of pride. That means something can be done, and I just don't know what it is. And all I have to do is figure it out or find out if I study hard enough. You see, I don't know what to do means this can be done. I just don't know how. But friends, sometimes there are just some things when I look at, you know, and I say, you know what? There's not a secret to this. There's not some trick to know. I can't do this. Can't do this. Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, returned to his house in peace to Jerusalem. Remember after the big fiasco, they went into the battle. God told them not to go into the battle. Ramoth of Gilead, and they did. King Ahab died. Someone drew a bow and then shot him. He bled to death in his chariot. After that was all over, he went back to his house in peace. And Jehu, the son of Hanani, the seer, went out to meet him and said to King Jehoshaphat, should you help the ungodly and love them that hate the Lord? Therefore is wrath upon you from before the Lord. Now, this is reflecting an Old Testament theology. Jesus told us to love our enemies and to forgive people and to pray for those who despitefully use us. It's difficult, however, and here we find the wrath of God resting upon King Jehoshaphat, because there are people who really just hate the Lord. And he's showing kindness to them. Nevertheless, there are good things found in you, and that you've taken away the groves out of the land. They would plant these beautiful little hilltop groves, trees and plants and shrubs. And that was a place that they dedicated to Ashtaroth, to their false gods that were in the area, that were worshipped in the area. You've taken down the groves, and you've prepared your heart to seek God. We talked about that recently. Jesus said in Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. He says, you have prepared your heart to seek God. And Jehoshaphat dwelt at Jerusalem, and he went out again among the people from Beersheba to Mount Ephraim, and brought them back to the Lord God of their fathers. Here's a king who is their political leader, their military leader, their royalty, Jehoshaphat, the king. But yet he feels that it's very important, as a part of what he does politically and militarily, is to bring his subjects to God. To bring his subjects to God. The founding fathers of our nation felt very strongly about this. They were men of great integrity and great intelligence and wisdom. I'm talking about Thomas Jefferson and John Adams, Benjamin Franklin, George Washington, our country's founding fathers. And they're a questionable grab bag of spiritualities. And yet, they turned to the Bible, to the Word of God, and to Christianity, and the Judeo-Christian truths based in the Scriptures for almost every document that is the founding words of our nation, the United States of America. Well, you just pull out a dollar bill and it says, in God we trust on it. If you go to Washington, D.C., you will see Scriptures displayed everywhere and statements about God and about the Word of God everywhere on almost every monument. He says he was bringing them back to the Lord. Let's look at the next slide, Carter. He set judges in the land throughout all the fenced cities of Judah, city by city. Do you know that most of the countries in the world today have closed borders, fences and walls and guards at the borders of their country? Almost every country in the world. It's only been in recent days that the United States of America has adopted an open borders policy. Listen, I've traveled all around the world, and I've had to get shots. Sometimes I go and get up to 15 and 20 inoculations and shots and things before I can go into a particular country because they said, well, why don't you bring in all your sickness over here? My arms would be all swollen up, and I'd be running a fever. And I haven't had to get visas. I've had to get passports. If you've done any traveling overseas, you know as well, too, that when you go from one country to the other, well, they'll dump out all your stuff on the floor. They'll make you just about halfway stripped down and take off your belt and your shoes. And they'll ask you questions, and they'll grill you. Where are you coming from? Where are you going to? What's your purpose, your reason for being here? And they've got your documentation. You've got to have your birth certificate, your passport, your visas. Well, it's something that we see here in the Old Testament that for thousands of years, when you have had cities and states and countries, that it's really just been a naturally accepted thing that you have boundaries and borders and fences. I don't know why all of a sudden the United States, you know, if you have locks on your doors and windows, and if you have protection in your home, I don't understand why anybody would complain about having the same kind of protection for people who are coming and going out of our country. Make a big deal out of it. That seems ridiculous to me. And he said to the judges, be careful of what you do, for you judge not for man, but for the Lord who is with you in the judgment. I believe a lot of judges, the book of James said, don't be many leaders, don't be many teachers. He says, you shouldn't try to work real hard to become a leader or a teacher. He says, because when they stand before God, they've got a lot to answer for. I believe some judges are going to stand before God one day. Every kind of judge imaginable. And God's going to say, didn't you know that when you were making a judgment, you were judging in my behalf? You were not just judging out of your own experience and your own wisdom. You were not supposed to judge just because you were in the circuit court or the Supreme Court or the appeals court. Every judge who's ever judged any kind of case in human history is going to have to stand before God. And it says, when you set yourself as a judge, or when you allowed yourself to be elected as a judge, or you became appointed as a judge, you're judging for the one true judge.
Amen.
And so King Jehoshaphat said, you Be careful. Be careful. And now let the fear of the Lord be on you. Be careful and do it. For there is no iniquity, the Lord our God, and no respect of persons, nor taking of gifts. Listen, there are people who are among our leaders in our nation today. They make pretty good money compared to what me and you make. They might make $200,000, $300,000, $400,000. But so many of them, if you look in their bank accounts, you know how much of that money they have in their bank accounts? Millions. Nor taking of gifts. How do you make $300,000, $400,000, $500,000 a year and have millions of dollars in your bank account? How do you do that? Now, somebody can say, well, I trade the stock market, or I sell real estate, or I buy this and sell that. Now, you might be many of them who could say, well, I don't just earn this salary. I have other investments. Okay, I would go for that. But there are some of them that all they do is make speeches, and they get paid $500,000 a speech. I have never heard of a humdinger of a speech like that. I've never heard a $500,000 sermon or speech. Believe me. And also in Jerusalem, Jehoshaphat set the Levites and the priests and the chief fathers of Israel for the judgment of the Lord and for the controversies and disputes among the people when they returned to Jerusalem. And he charged them, saying, do this in the fear of the Lord faithfully and with a perfect heart. What it means is he went out and he believed that the spiritual people in his kingdom, the spiritual leaders, needed to hold positions in his kingdom in overseeing and helping him lead the people. I have to tell you right now that ministers, preachers, pastors, Christian leaders are not held in very high regard. Much of it has to do with our own testimony and our failure to have a pure heart. But you would find today that people do not generally turn to spiritual leaders anymore when they're looking for assistance or guidance. Let's look at the next slide. And whatever cause shall come to you and of your brothers that dwell in their cities between blood and blood, between law and commandments, statutes and judgments, you will even warn them not to trespass against the Lord and to bring his wrath upon you and upon your brethren. This do, and you will not trespass. Now he says, you need to tell everybody that this is not about doing what the king says. This is not about doing what the governor says. This is not about doing what the president says. He says, tell them to do what God says. To do what God says. And Amariah, the chief priest, is over you all in matters of the Lord, and Zabadiah, the son of Ishmael, the ruler of the house of Judah. For all the king's matters, also the Levites, shall be officers before you. Deal courageously, and the Lord will be with the good. Alright? Let's look at the next slide. This is in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. After that, the children of Moab, the children of Ammon, and the others with them came against Jehoshaphat to battle. Then there came some of that told Jehoshaphat, saying, a great multitude is coming against you from beyond the sea on the side of Syria. They are in Hatzatzantamar, which is in Gedi. And Jehoshaphat was afraid and set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. And the citizens of Judah gathered together to ask help of the Lord. They came out of all the cities of Judah. And Jehoshaphat stood in the congregation of Judah at Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court and said, O Lord God of our fathers, aren't you the God in heaven? Don't you rule over all the kingdoms of the heathen? You see, God, he's asking a rhetorical question, but the answer is yes. God rules all the kingdoms, even the kingdoms of the heathen. God's in charge. You think there are some Muslim nations out there, some Hindu nations? You think there are some pagan nations, some atheistic nations like communist Russia or communist China? And that they're out of God's realm? No. He says, you're God of all kingdoms of the heathen. Isn't there power and might in your hand so that none are able to stand against you? All right. He He's asking God questions I'm sure God knows the answer to. Aren't you our God who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and gave it to the seed of Abraham? Your friend forever? And they dwelt there. They built you a sanctuary there for your name, saying, if when the evil comes like sword or judgment or pestilence or famine, we stand before this house and in your presence, for your name is in this house, and cry out to you in our affliction, then you will help and hear us. You will hear us and help. And now, behold, the children of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, whom you would not let Israel invade when they came out of the land of Egypt, but according to your instructions, they turned from them and destroyed them not. This is so keen right here. He says, you know these people that are coming to get us? You told us not to fight them or wipe them out when we first got here. So this is kind of your fault, God. You ever feel like some of the trouble you're in, that if God had been paying attention, you wouldn't be in that trouble in the first place? He says, these Moabites and these Ammonites, you told us to leave them alone. Because you see, they're kind of like distant kin. They were Lot's children's children. Lot, you know, he was the nephew of Abraham. So you told us not, because they're kind of like family. He said, well, that's the one that's coming to get me. Remember you told. And he says, look how they reward us to come to cast us out of your possession, which you have given us to inherit. Oh, our God, won't you judge them? For we have no might against this great company that comes against us. Neither know we what to do. We don't know what to do. They're coming. But our eyes are upon you. And all Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones and their wives and their children. Lord, we don't know what to do. I think it takes a very big person sometimes to say, I don't know, or I can't. I'm not able to. It's beyond me. We don't have to let the story stop there, because we can say, you know, I know God, and my God can do anything. My God can do anything. He can do the impossible. So it doesn't, if I can't help you, that doesn't mean that things are helpless or hopeless. If I can't fix this, it doesn't mean it's not fixable, because God can fix anything. Let's look at the next slide. Then upon Jahaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaiah, the son of Jael, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite of the sons of Asaph, came the Spirit of the Lord. It says that the Spirit of the Lord came upon him in the midst of the congregation, and he said, listen, all Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem, and King Jehoshaphat, this is what the Lord says to you. Don't be afraid or dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Do you remember somebody else who stood before an impossible enemy and said, the battle is the Lord's? Who said that?
King David.
David said that.
Well, when he was a little boy.
Yeah, he's a little boy. He's about to fight Goliath. And he says, are you going to go out there and fight that giant? He says, look, the battle is the Lord's. The battle is the Lord's. The battle is not yours, but it is God's. Tomorrow go down against them. Look, they come up by the cliff of Ziz. I wonder if they had decided they was going to come up that way yet or not. Listen very carefully. God knows the battle plans of all your enemies. He knows the steps of all those who hate you. God knows all the plans of the wicked. You may not. You may just know they're coming. All I know, God says, well, they're going to be at the foot of the hill down there by Ziz. That's where they're going to be at tomorrow. And you know, when they were hit, here's all these Ammonites and these Moabites, and they said, listen, we need to get a plan. And somebody said, you know, we need to go up here through this valley, but down there, right down there, for the hill by us is. And somebody said, that sounds like a good plan. God's going. They're going to come up by the cliff of Ziz, and you will find them at the end of the brook before the wilderness of Jeruel. You won't need to fight this battle. You won't need to fight this battle. Set yourselves, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord who is with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you. And Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground. And all of Judah in the heavens of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. And the Levites and the children of the Kohathites and all the children of the Korahites, you'll find their names in the Psalms. They're the music directors of Psalms. Stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel with a loud voice on high. Let's look at another slide. They rose early in the morning and went out to the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah and you inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God. Believe in the Lord your God. In that way you'll be established. Believe his prophets and you will prosper. When he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers to the Lord. Do you know when you're singing, you're not singing to me? Whenever you sing as a Christian, as a child of God, you're not singing to each other. Do you know that when Jason Reynolds comes to sing with us, he's not coming here to sing to you or to sing to me. Anybody who actually has the Spirit of the Lord upon them, you'll find it so many times in the Scripture that they will only be blessed and only be a blessing if they come singing to the Lord. So they sang to the Lord. They began to sing and to praise the Lord and set a trap for the children of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, which were coming against Judah, and they were smitten. For the children of Ammon and Moab stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir, utterly to destroy, to slay and destroy them. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, everyone helped destroy another. You see, when they got to the place there at the foot of the hill at Ziz, they didn't really like. You'll find this about ungodly people. They're all very selfish. They're all very self-centered. They don't care about anybody or nothing at all but themselves. And they saw, you know, there's a bunch of us here, and we've been not liking the people from Mount Seir for a long time anyway, so let's, while we got them here, let's kill all of them. And they did. And then they started killing each other. They began, everyone helped to destroy another. I've interjected a little more politics and commentary on our country's leadership in the last few months of my sermons. But all you have to do is look at our leaders today. Does it look like they're trying to help you? Does it look like that the most important thing about them is protecting you and guiding you and benefiting you? Or are they just more intent on destroying each other? There's no doubt in my mind that as I read the newspapers and as I watch the news on television, that I see in Washington, D.C., that their number one concern is not what they can do for you and me. But what is number one on their list is how can we destroy each other? How can we destroy each other? Everyone helped to destroy another. And when Judah came, and let me tell you what, wherever you stand in that argument, who wins? Who wins? Nobody. Nobody wins. The Democrats don't win, the Republicans don't win, the Independents, the Libertarians don't win, the American people don't win, nobody wins. And when Judah came toward the watchtower in the wilderness, they looked up to the multitude and behold, all they saw was dead bodies falling to the earth. None escaped. Here's the last slide. What do? You may have had success in the past depending upon your own abilities, your own skills, your own intelligence, and your own craftiness. Your own abilities. There may be people that you have great confidence in, and you have turned to them in the past, people who have helped you, people who have rescued you. That may be yours. But I believe that there are going to come times. And I believe, listen, friends, if you face a situation, if there's something that you can do, don't be lazy. Don't always be depending upon other people to help you out. Don't always be leaning upon the assistance of others. If there's something that you can do, do it. If there's something that you can fix, fix it. If there is something that you can tackle and knock it down, knock it down. But there are going to be times in your life when you face situations when you're not going to know what to do. You're not going to know of anyone that you can turn to for help. Should God be our last resort? Someone in a church business meeting was mentioning a problem that the church had, and then one of the deacons said, well, let's just pray about it. And somebody says, oh Lord, has it come to that? Has it come to that? Say, prayer, is that all we got? Man, it's worse than I thought. It's worse than I thought if we just got to pray about it. God is our last resort. You know, I don't think he reminds that all that much. As a matter of fact, I think he stands back sometimes and says, well, go on. Just go ahead. Try everything you can try. Fortunately, in this story, they didn't have to get down there in the midst of the battle. Jehoshaphat had already been in the midst of a battle before and said, help! And God helped him. He smarted up a little bit. He said, you know what? I am going to get in this fight. I'm not even going to march down the hill. I'm not going to put my armor on and get in the middle of it with the arrows and the spears flying everywhere to find out that I need help from God. Jehoshaphat, pretty smart guy. He said, you know what? I've been in this situation before. I've been thinking that I'm the king, and I'm going to go down here into battle. King Jehoshaphat says, man, I'll tell you what, God, I don't know what to do here. I don't know. God, I'm not even sure there is anything at all that I can do. I think sometimes, you know, God doesn't get mad or upset. He's just waiting on me and you. He just waits. I'm just waiting for us to look up and say, Lord, help us. God says, all right. God starts, let me roll up my sleeves here a little bit. God says, let me wait just a minute. He says, pivot. And Jehoshaphat says, what do you want us to do? He says, I'll tell you what. I want you to do anything. I just want you to go here because I want you to see it. I want you to see it. And I want you to get up here on the mountains and on the ridge, and I just want you to go up there. And he said, I want you to stay still. I just want you to stand still and watch the salvation of the Lord. He says, you just watch. Behold, all they saw was dead bodies falling to the earth. None escaped. God says, let me show you what I can do. And it won't even break a sweat. Let me tell you what I can do. Listen, friends, I'm kind of out here in the crowd and looking up at the king. If you think King Jehoshaphat has got all the answers and he's going to fix everything, you're dead wrong. If you think the priests and the Levites and the singers, if you think if they would just do this way or that way, everything would be all right, you're dead wrong. If you're looking at a situation, if you're looking at a problem, if you're looking at any kind of difficulty, and you say, if this person or that person, they could fix this. Or maybe if they brought a different person in, if we had two other different people or five other different people, maybe. The thing about it is that most of us don't believe that God can do anything. That God can fix anything, that he can resolve anything. We don't really believe that he can. And a lot of times we think that if we ask him to do something for us, he'd say, well, I don't agree with you. I don't believe that needs to be done. I don't believe that that's the plan of action. A lot of times when I have ideas about how the way things should be done, I'm pretty sure that that's not God's way of doing things. That's why a lot of times I don't ask him for his help. Because I'd really rather do things my way than his way. But that's very, very bad reasoning. And that's just looking for a fault. What do you do when there's nothing you can do? Well, what will God do? This is just one example of what he did for these people during this time. God is not at our beck and call. He is not our servant. He's not our slave. There are no verses of Scripture in the Bible that we can take and hit God over the head with to make Him do what we want Him to do. But let me tell you what. He's your best hope. He's always going to be your best bet. He's always going to be the one who always, always, always knows what to do. And He can do it. There are lots of things that I do. Lots of things that I try to do. A lot of things that I know. Not much as I'd like to know. Still very, very, very ignorant in the big scheme of things. But any time, I'd rather see what God can do than what I can do. Every Sunday when I come here, I say, Lord, we can either see what I can do today, or we can see what You do. I get so tired of seeing what I can do. You know, there have been a number of occasions in my ministry, Terry can tell you these stories too, where we've started to sing, and God came in and said, that's enough singing. Let's do something. I've been where I was in a big church that I was their guest, and I was up, me and a friend of mine were up next to sing next. And their minister of music and his wife got over to the piano and began to sing a song. And our big our evangelist, we were headed to India to be missionaries for God. And we were their guests that day, but they'd sung about two hymns, and then they started singing at the piano. And God just decided that was all that He wanted to hear that day. I love it when God comes down and interrupts a music service. He can do it. It didn't have anything to do with the songs or the music. There have been times myself when I've stood up to preach, and before I could even begin my sermon, God began doing what only He could do. I had to just put my sermon away. God doesn't need my sermons, or our songs, or our prayers. I believe that we have failed to believe that God and to depend upon Him instead of ourselves, or depending upon others. The psalmist said, I'm putting all my hope in God because my expectation is from Him. I'm not expecting anything from anybody else. Let's pray for us today. Lord Jesus, thank You for Your grace and goodness. How long will it take us to learn? You can do anything. And if things need to be different, You can make them different. You can change them. You can change me. You can change us.